Researchers at the Soldier Institute for Nanotechnologies at MIT have created a method by which they can use light to pull out polymers and create this microscopic lattice structure. That structure creates a stronger and more resistant type of material that actually, at a very, very tiny level, is stronger than steel and even Kevlar, which is used in most body armor and helmets today.
The background of this research is this field of architected materials. And what that is materials whose microstructure, or in this case, nanostructure, is really determined a priori, so before you fabricate it. So it's all intentionally designed and placed in a certain way. And over the last decade, we've seen a lot of progress in this field. We've been testing and making these new materials with different architectures and seeing these very novel properties such as high stiffness, high strength, but also extremely low weight. You start off with a substrate, which in our case is just a silicon chip, and then you put a drop of a photoresist or your resin. And then this laser, you can actually tightly focus it at a very small nanoscale spot. And wherever this spot gets traced, you locally solidify. So that's how we make our 3D architectures. We simply trace this voxel or this small focal point throughout this drop of the photoresist. Once we solidify what we're interested in solidifying, then we wash off the photoresist that we did not polymerize. And that leaves us with our polymeric structure. We first start with a design in a computer, and we design this three-dimensional geometry that then we can repeat infinitely or however many times we want, depending on how big we want to make this material. And it is exactly these different shapes, these different architectures, what give rise to these novel mechanical properties. So once we have this computer-aided design, what we do is we input it in one of our nanoscale 3D printers, which is actually called a two-photon lithography process. And we 3D print these materials with very, very small, very low, high resolution, so very small features. And once we fabricate them, so you can imagine just like any other 3D printer, it's a polymer-based material, but we take it through a thermal process stage, which converts this polymer into carbon. And carbon now gives us this much stiffer mechanical properties, higher modulus, higher strength, and we retain this geometry that we started with. So that is why the core of why these materials are strong.
So scientists with the project explained to Army Times that the best way to understand this is if you had, say, a motorcycle helmet. Now that helmet has a protective shell. It protects the rider if they crash or bump their head in any way. But it basically has one or two layers of protection. That's kind of where Kevlar and steel are now in traditional armors or traditional kinds of body armor type protective equipment. With this microscopic way of structuring nanotechnologies, you're essentially creating multiple shells, multiple layers within the same space at a lighter weight. So every time one of those layers meets resistance, it's providing extra protection. So more layers means more protection, means a way to actually do lighter armor in the same amount of space with this new technology.
So if we're talking about protective materials. So what's used today, you know, at least state of the art would be, you know, Kevlar composites. So these are composites which are made of fibers, very stiff fibers, which are either woven or arranged in certain patterns. But there really are kind of a 2D pattern that's layered on top of each other. You can make it thicker and thicker depending on what kind of event you're trying to stop. The difference really now is that we can take advantage of 3D architecture. So we're not relying on 2D patterns, but instead we make our 3D pattern already. And that gives rise to very interesting dissipation mechanisms. You can imagine this is kind of like a foam. It takes energy to compact this foam. And that gives rise to energy dissipation upon impact. There are still a lot of open questions that need to be validated before we can say this is ready for direct application by troops, for instance. One key hurdle is the scalability fabrication of these materials. So we want to be able to fabricate these materials at you know, square meter length scales eventually. That is one hurdle that has not been easily solved yet. So I would say there's definitely a lot of research that has to be done. I'd say maybe in about 5 to 10 years, we can start seeing some indications of of the potential applicability of these materials.
Now, why this is important, it's really part of a bigger picture approach and an umbrella type of a program that the Army's always going after, which is making things lighter and more protective by using new materials, new methods, new science. And that's important because every year the modern battlefield gets more and more deadly. Enemies are always advancing their ways of attacking us. We're advancing our ways of defending ourselves and also attacking back. And so this just helps soldiers and hopefully protects them and future equipment and future battlefields. This is Todd South of Military Times.